Good evening, everyone. It's good to see so many people on so early. We're grateful that God has given us strength again to make it one more week. Here we are. We're such a blessed people. This evening, we want to start with prayer, and we want to ask God to touch the lives of people who are out there struggling right now. First of all, welcome to each and every one of you. Thank you for taking the time out to join us. Where we take this opportunity to always go into the word of the Lord, and of course to pray for each other. This evening, let's believe God, because there are so many prayer requests that have been coming through to us over the past, I would say, 2 weeks maybe, just lots of sicknesses and people going through struggles. And so we want to pray this evening, and we want to also pray that God would bless his children. We're going through a time of transition right now within our society, not just our society here in the United States of America, but certainly throughout the entire world. Some people are still struggling with COVID while other nations are making it through. We're so grateful here in New York that we have been doing much better than a lot of places in the United States of America and the world. And we ought to thank God for that. But let's also pray for those who are going through the struggle. And let's pray that we'll all come through this together. Amen. Let's go before the Lord in prayer. Mighty God, we come to you right now. We're so grateful for this opportunity to come online and to talk to you, God, and share as we pray for each other. We also pray, God, for your children out there, God, who are just struggling day by day. So many Christians that are young in the Lord, and they still haven't, Lord God, gotten their marching shoes on as yet, and they're just trying to make it from day to day. We pray for them that you would bring encouragement to their hearts, God, and Christians who have been living for a while with you, but God, it's just been such a hard battle for them, climbing up the steep hill of life, trying to make it day by day, and some days feeling as though they're just not going to be able to make it. But God, we're here to let them know tonight that you've got them. And Lord, you're a protector. Your promises are true. Today, God, we pray for those who are sick and afflicted. Would you heal them right now? All the prayer requests that's come in, God, for people, Lord, who have been sick, not just with COVID, but cancers and heart disease and liver failure, kidney failure, Lord. People who are in comas and are struggling out there, God, with the aftermath of COVID. We pray right now in the name of Jesus. God, we bind all these sicknesses and diseases and we cast them into outer darkness and we lose healing. God, we also bind and cast out all lack, all joblessness, homelessness, hunger, God. And we release blessings and resources, Lord, such as relationships. God, we don't just want to have any kind of relationship, but Lord God, relationships, Lord God, that are godly, whether they be godly marriages and friendships and partnerships, God, that will lift us up and allow us to flow, God, in our gifts and anointings and godly purpose, God. I release peace in every home. I release financial blessings and jobs and careers and businesses, multiple streams of income, God, and people, resources that will partner with us, God, to accomplish all that you have declared and decreed for us to do, God. People that are placed strategically, God, in our paths that will build us up and never tear us down. God, properties, God, and full ownerships with no money owed to anyone. God, open doors of multiple streams of resources and income, God, so that we can take care of all of our debts, mighty God. I release an abundance, God, in all good and godly things upon our lives so that we can be a blessing to others in need. Lord, would you forgive us of all our sins? Help us to forgive others and to let go of all bitterness and not walk around, God, with our hurts as a banner, carrying it like a flag, but trusting in the Lord. Help us never to seek nor to crave vengeance against anyone. Strengthen us, God. Keep us. Open our hearts and our minds, and we'll give you the praise, the glory, and the honor tonight. And would somebody say in Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah.
How do we define the word unity? After all, we hear it all the time. Unity in jobs, unity in our schools, and unity in our church. But what is the implication behind the word? Is it nothing more than a group of people working, learning, or worshiping together, loosely linked by a common goal or belief? Perhaps unity begins as nothing more than an empty cup. A framework created to house something bigger than itself. A vehicle built to contain a combination of ingredients, each with their own special qualities that make them unique. Each consisting of elements and properties that make it perfectly suited to fulfill its purpose. Together, each piece makes its own valuable contribution, regardless of its use as a singular item. Individually, each element is by no means worthless, but when combined together by the hands of a skilled creator, they become something wonderful. A delicious blend of unity.
Amen. Don't you want a delicious blend of unity tonight? Amen. God is such a good God. I want us to go in the word of the Lord tonight in 1 Peter chapter 2, and we're going to read from verse 10 through to, from verse 4 rather, through to verse 10. And I want to talk about identity check. We're continuing with that series, And would the real Christians please stand up? In these last days, we need Christians who are strong, proud of who they are, that they're solid in the Word of God, solid in their walk with God. They're never ashamed of exemplifying Jesus Christ to our world. It's not easy, especially when you feel such pressure from family and friends, to be otherwise. But remember that you're called, you're chosen. And if you're called and you're chosen, then what a privilege it is to walk with the Lord on your side. We can never be ashamed of that walk. Amen? And so tonight we want to go to the Word of God. We're talking about the spiritual house tonight. Amen. The spiritual house. Identity check. How is your spiritual house tonight? How is it? How's it coming along? How's the building of your spiritual house coming along? In 1 Peter chapter 2, beginning at verse 4, it says, "To whom, coming as unto a living stone, disallowed indeed of men, but chosen of God and precious, ye also as lively stones are built up a spiritual house and holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. Wherefore also it is contained in the scripture, Behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he that believeth on him shall not be confounded. Unto you therefore which believe, he is precious. But unto them which be disobedient, the stone which the builders disallowed, the same is made the head of the corner. And a stone of stumbling, and a rock of offense, even to them which stumble at the word, being disobedient, whereunto also they were appointed. But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, an holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, which in time past were not a people, but are now the people of God, which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy." Isn't God good? What a word. Just reading it alone gives us so much. And before I even continue, I want to pray over the word right now that God will bless our hearts and our minds, our spirits, our emotions, and give us something that will keep us and help us along the road as we walk closer in our walk with Christ. Lord, we come to you again. We ask you to anoint the word. Give us unction. God, give us the anointing to speak your word. But more than anything else, God, speak through your word to us so that we may grow thereby. And everybody said, in Jesus' name, amen. One note here. We are going to be having two services on Mother's Day. And so we are going to begin registration beginning on April 26th, pretty much just as we did for Easter. So this is a special registration, and it will be 2 weeks before Mother's Day so that we can get an understanding of how many people will be coming and ensure that we're strategically aligned to be able to accommodate the right amount of people for both services. So again, we ask for your input. And also, please remember that when you register and you cancel, please ensure that you cancel not Sunday morning and not even Saturday night, unless it's an emergency. Please cancel way before that so that we can get an opportunity to inform someone else that wants to come to church that there's a spot or two or three opened up, and this way we can get them in. Amen. Let's be considerate of one another. It's unfortunate, but we've been having a rash of people just not showing up, registering and not showing up. And unfortunately, we don't know it until it's too late and we can't get other people in that want to be in church. So we ask for your cooperation in this regard. Amen. So again, that's going to be on the 26th. Of April that will begin registration, open registration, and you'll have the opportunity to register for either the early service or the later service, which is literally 1 hour later. All right? So let's get back into the word of the Lord. I want you to note some things here in terms of what was written by the Apostle Peter. He said, to whom, to whom coming as unto a lively stone, disallowed of men, but chosen of God and precious. He's talking about Jesus Christ here, that was because of the disobedience of people and because of their inability to love the scriptures, the word of God, they not only didn't know who he was, and even if they did, they didn't care. They pushed him to the side. The stone that if the builders forgot to put in to the corner, the chief cornerstone this was, the building would not be able to stand. And so when we read the word of God, we see that Peter is also identifying us as stones in the building. We're not the chief cornerstone, Jesus is, but we are in the building. He says, ye also as lively stones, verse 5, are built up a spiritual house and holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. So we are precious to God. We are important to the Lord. And every time you think about your life and you think about all that you're going through, the toils, the snares that sometimes come up in your life, and you're wondering to yourself, is God even thinking about me? I'm here to let you know, according to the word of God, he is. In fact, he considers us as precious in his sight, precious in his sight. So we are a spiritual house. And it says here in verse 8, a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense, even to them which stumble at the word, being disobedient. So just as they stumbled at Christ because of their disobedience to the word, they will stumble at you. Every time you try to talk to family and friends and co-workers, and you try to tell them that Jesus is the way, that if you want a change in your life, you know, the medication isn't helping you, the psychiatrists and psychologists, they're putting you on all kinds of meds, and they're trying to help you to be able to deal with your emotional struggles. And here is Christ waiting in the wings that wants to give you a miracle of peace. But because we have not obeyed the word and we are not seeking after him, there are so many people, even Christians, who are not walking deep as we should. Many times we're going through struggles, but we're not deep in the Lord. We have a surface relationship. We do not want to be that kind of a stone in the building. We want to be a stone that the Lord will pick up and say, yeah, I can use this. I can use this to build my house. Amen. And so we find here in verse nine, it says, but ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood. So we are precious. We are a spiritual house. Peter would understand the idea of Jesus as the living stone. Amen. The rock upon which the world, or which the church rather, would be founded, because the Lord spoke to him about it. And he says, upon this rock will I build my church. Matthew 16 and verse 16 through 9. And let me read that for you. I'm putting the scripture up there for you. It says, when Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And they said, some say that thou art John the Baptist, some Elias, that's Elijah, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. In verse 15, he said unto them, but whom say ye that I am? I know what the world is saying, but what about you? You're close to me. What are you saying about me? Who am I? And Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus responds this way, blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock, not Peter, but on the rock, the fact that the revelation of who Jesus Christ is, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on the earth shall be loosed in heaven. So that's Matthew chapter 16. Now, the Apostle Paul wrote to the Ephesian church, giving them an image, of Christians as comprising a spiritual house. Ephesians 2 and verse 19 through 21. And he says this, now therefore, ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God. Don't tell me you're not precious in the Lord's sight. Imagine that we who were not even a people, were not born of the commonwealth of Israel, we are now a part of this wonderful household of God. And verse 20 says, and are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus himself being the chief cornerstone. So he is the foundation, and everybody else, all of us, the apostles, the prophets, the church, the saints of the living God, we all are lively stones in the building of this house, this wonderful house of God. Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. And in verse 21 of Ephesians 2, it says, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth unto an holy temple in the Lord. So we are a part of the temple of the Lord. Every single person that comes into Christ through repentance, baptism in Jesus' name, the infilling of the Holy Ghost, speaking in tongues, that individual is a lively stone that the Lord is using to build his temple, his holy temple. And as much as we don't want to think about it, and by sometimes the way we act and the things we say to one another, it's as though we have forgotten that we are in his temple, and that because we are a part of the temple, we should be careful how we act and handle one another, because he's watching. In fact, he's the one you taking us and putting us where he wants us to be. Amen. So we must work together as a unit in the body of Christ. Now, Christians, we do work together. We try to do things together for the most part, and we exist together. And most of the time, we want to exist together to become something greater than we are as an individual. Okay? We exist together to become something greater than we are as individuals. So in the body of Christ, it's not about the individual. It's not about us. It's not about the individual that likes to be seen, like to be heard, like to take the stage front and center. That's not what this is about. It's about the whole. Hallelujah. And so when we go to Romans chapter 12, and we're going to read verses 3 on, and it says, for I say through the grace given unto me to every man. This is the Apostle Paul writing to the Roman church. He says, for I say through the grace given unto me to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly. The apostle is saying, let's slow it down a little bit. Before Christ, it was all about us. Before Christ, it was all about those that we loved and, you know, forget about everybody else. They're just the people that I invite into my inner circle. Those are the people that I build up. They build me up. I build them up. And that's it. The apostle Paul says, no, hold on a second. We cannot think of ourselves more highly than we ought to, but we should think soberly. Verse 4 says, for as we have many members in one body, and all members have not the same office, so we being many are one body in Christ, and everyone members one of another. Verse 6 says, having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us, whether prophecy, let us prophesy according to the proportion of faith, ministry, let us wait on our ministering, or he that teacheth on teaching, or he that exhorteth on exhortation, he that giveth, let him do it with simplicity, he that ruleth with diligence, he that shows mercy with cheerfulness. Now notice that he's talking about a few things here. You may not see your gifting here, because not everybody's an apostle, a prophet. Not everybody prophesies. Not everybody is going to be in ministry, as we call it. And sometimes we toss that word ministry around so much. And we take titles out and we slap them on people. And, you know, I don't have any issues when people are slapping titles on, just as long as we're doing things within context and we're ensuring that we're not deviating from the word of God, because not everybody's called to be a preacher. Not everybody's called to be an apostle, a prophet, a pastor, an evangelist, a teacher. That's right. Not everybody's called to those things. And sometimes we may have the gift of gab, but we're not even called to preach. The fact that we can talk doesn't mean I'm a preacher. We have to be called by the Lord. You know, before David was anointed king, the Lord sent out the prophet, the man of God, to go and to call him. The Apostle Paul, when he was literally thrown off his horse by the presence of Almighty God, and he found out that he was talking to the Lord God Almighty, the Bible tells us that the Lord told him that he is calling him to go out to the Gentiles. He's going out there and he's going to preach this word. The Lord gave him a word that he was called. If someone lays hands on you and you didn't get that calling and they tell you, I don't care if it's a prophet, the Lord called you, you better make sure that you've gotten your own calling. You've got to get your calling. I remember many years ago when I was a young man, someone laid hands on me and said, God has called you to preach. And I knew that God had called me to preach, but I wasn't ready to preach. And I remembered that because it confirmed what God had spoken to me. But the confirmation came from my pastor, actually from two separate pastors. And I never forgot that. The Lord had laid it on my heart to always study his word. It didn't matter what was going on in my life. Amen. I would read the word. I would document the word every single day. I would spend 2 hours because I was always on that train going into work, into the city. And I was always in the word and I was documenting and I would always get into it. There was a joy in my spirit about sharing that word. I would teach at work and opportunities that came up to teach Bible studies, I would grab them. I didn't ask anybody, should I go teach a Bible study? The Bible studies were out there in the world to teach. And if someone needed a word, I was ready to give a word. When you're called, there's something about teaching the word. There's something about holding yourself accountable to the word. That's very important because you, as a preacher, cannot hold others accountable when you're not holding yourself accountable. I know a lot of that is going on in the world today, but Mr. Preacher, you, Miss Preacher, you need to hold yourself accountable more than you hold anybody else accountable. So here he is. He's speaking about something that's very important. He's saying, out of all of these ministries, whatever it is and giftings, callings that God has placed on your life, there's some things that's important here. According to this Bible passage, we should humble ourselves before the Lord. The word soberly in verse 3 means thoughtfully. In other words, think before you act, right? Exercise self-control. So here we're finding that the Apostle Paul is not just saying, hey, listen, we're part of the body. We're lively stones. We're being made to become the holy temple of God as we are all pulled in together to do the work of the living God. But before we get all excited about running out there and doing ministry, let's start looking at some things here. We should be humble. We should be sober, right? That is to be thoughtful, to think before we act, to exercise self-control. And then you notice he talks about the different roles, the different offices. In other words, what God has called us to do in the kingdom of God. You see, we may be different offices, but we are one body in Christ. We're connected to one another according to verse 5. It says, members one of another. Members one of another. And so according to the grace, is not what the Bible says, right? Whatever your gift, your talents are, it is according to the grace that is given to us. Our gifts, our talents given to us by the divine influence of God upon our hearts to work, to accomplish the various tasks that God has given to us in his kingdom. You know, we don't have to fight for roles in the church. I remember someone coming to me one time and they were saying, Pastor Henry, there's got to be something around here in the church for me to do. And I was looking at the individual and then I said, have you taught a Bible study lately? And they looked at me, no, no, no. I said, you know, everybody wants to do stuff in the body of Christ, in the building, the church where all the saints are. But I remember a song saying, my house is full, but my field is empty. Who will go and work for me today? It seems my children, the Lord says, all want to stay around my table, but no one wants to go work in my field. No one wants to go work in my field. And so it's important for us to do whatever is necessary in the house of God. God has set over the church a pastor. That's the elder of the body, the local body. And so there are so many different things that can be done. And then there are people who need to be trained and taught before they actually get involved at certain levels. That's very important. The Bible says to know them that labor among you. The one thing I never, ever stop a person from doing is giving your testimony to family and friends. And if you want to teach a Bible study, you don't know how to teach it, to teach you how to teach a Bible study so that you can reach out. I want to know what people are doing out there before they even start worrying about what they want to do in the body of Christ, because that tells me that there's a burden in the hearts of individuals to build the kingdom of God. And they're not just waiting until they get to the church building to do it, but that they're doing it out there. And so the Apostle Paul is very, you know, he's speaking here in such a way that it's giving us an opportunity to understand. He's telling the Romans, listen, we're doing what we're doing according to the grace that is given to us. And then he says, it's based on the proportion of faith. So everybody's different. Everybody's skilled in a different way. Everybody's blessed in a different way. And some people, quite frankly, they've got to develop their skills. Mm-hmm. See, you may have a desire to do something, but you're not ready for it yet. It's according to the time frame of God. When God says it's time to release you, you'll be released. So even though you may have a talent and a gift, and you may do so much, and in fact, you're better at it than anybody else, you may still not be ready because your attitude isn't right. Amen. And sometimes we have to sit people down because the attitude isn't right. We have to say to someone, no, you need more training. The attitude may be right, but they need more training so that they know how to deal with people and to be compassionate. If you've not been through something, how can you tell somebody else in ministry, through your ministry, what they should and should not do when you've never experienced what they're going through? I remember years ago, my pastor looked at me. We were talking and I said, you know, Pastor, I've been going through so much and I don't understand. And he put a smile on his face. He says, you can't pastor anybody unless you've gone through something. How can you tell people about their issues if you've not gone through some things? If you've not experienced issues with others that has taught you patience and taught you how to deal with certain types of situations, how in the world are you going to do it? And, you know, I never forgot that. And it's the same with the children of the Lord, the body of Christ. Many of us are called, but we're not ready to go out and to do certain things. Now, witnessing, yes. Teaching Bible studies, once you know, listen, if you have three scriptures, you can teach a Bible study on three scriptures. Just tell them from your heart. But to teach someone to understand the doctrine, to teach someone what it means to be baptized and what baptism means and what the Holy Ghost is, why tongues for today, how to walk with the Lord, how to be strategic in your walk with God, how to stand when everything is against you and scripturally do those things, and how to pray and pray right according to scriptures. All that requires a lot of teaching and revelation, not because we're trying to get something new, but revelation to you because you've never heard it before and the word needs to be taught to you. That's why you have prophets and pastors and apostles and evangelists and teachers, because the saints need to be perfected in the body. Amen. So it's according to the grace. We need to develop ourselves. Our talents is according to the proportion of faith. But notice Romans 10 and verse 17. This is important here. See, faith grows through learning, time, and experience. So then faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. Faith comes through learning. We're growing in the word, and then our faith grows. Time and experience causes us to have our faith tested. Do you see it? So as we are growing in faith, that faith needs to be tested. That's why we go through the things we go through. We don't like it, but we must go through some things because your faith is tested. So you say, Pastor, are you saying that every time I see something about my life that needs to be changed, and every time I get to that place where I have more faith and I just feel like I can just move all kinds of mountains, how are you not going to know if you can move mountains if the Lord doesn't put a mountain in your path for you to move? Are you getting it? So sometimes we're wondering why all of this, because then remember, God has given you gifts and talents, and he's also put strategically now people in our paths that need deliverance, need help. Family members, friends, sometimes close people in relationships with us, and if they have a mountain in their lives and you've never moved a mountain for yourself, how can you help somebody else with theirs? Come on now. How can you build up their most holy faith when you're still working on yours? Do you see why we can't just go out there and grab a hold of ministry? I remember someone once said to me, Pastor, why is it that you don't bring a lot of preachers into the church? You know, I'm very slow. I watch pastors through the years do this, and oh, they paid the price for it. And I remember one pastor, there was someone that was coming into New York, and he said, I want you to bring this man to your church. I said, no. He said, why not? I said, I don't know him because I don't know his life. What has he lived? Where is his experience? I've never heard him preach. How can I bring that individual before the people? I watch people before they are set up to preach because I want to know you got to walk with God. And, you know, he looked at me and he said something which is important and interesting. And for those pastors who want to go that route, that's fine. And he said, well, if he does something, you're the pastor, just set it right. Well, I don't want to set anything right. I want to make sure it's right before they get into the pulpit. It's the same with our walk with God. Before we go out there, we've got to make sure we set ourselves right in the kingdom. We've got to know the word. We've got to have experiences that causes us, remember that word, be humble, be sober. In other words, be careful of how we approach people. I remember a man came to our church many, many years ago. I was young, so young, and this man, ooh, my goodness, the pastor was at church and he was allowed to preach, and this man was preaching stuff that when pastor came, he had to fix so much stuff. This man tore our church up. We can't just put anybody out there, and we can't just go out there without knowing what is right and to be under order and leadership. Now you say, what does that mean? It means that you don't go out there and teach and preach without knowing that your pastor has sanctioned you. And if you're out there teaching and you're not seasoned and you've not really gotten the go-ahead from your pastor, you need to say, Pastor, I need to talk with you. I need to teach. If I feel that you don't have enough in terms of your knowledge, because I know you, because you either don't show up for Bible studies, you may say, well, I learned in another church. I don't know that. I need to know what you know. And because you may represent our church, then I need to be able to speak into your life. And that's what we call being under authority. The Apostle Paul was more educated than Peter and all of the other apostles in the law. And also in worldly things. He was a writer. The other apostles, for the most part, except for maybe one or two of the others, didn't even know how to write. But the Apostle Paul did. But I noticed something. When the Lord brought him to that place where he had to be baptized and receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, he had to go to Jerusalem and submit himself to unlearned men that were apostles and submit to the authority that they had over him in the church. And he could not go out and preach even to the Gentiles, even though he was called by the Lord, until they sent him out. So there's order in the body, right? And this faith comes by the hearing of the word of God. Then we need patience. Oh, my goodness. There it is. Pastor, let me loose. Let me loose. Stop holding me back. Stop quenching my ministry. Let me tell you, you don't have any ministry that God has not sanctioned. And anytime we have a gifting, there should also be someone in authority over you. All of us need that. Even me as a pastor, I've got a bishop over me. So we all need authority, amen, over us. And there's some things that I will not do, even though I'm the pastor of our church. And I can do whatever I want to do in our the churches in the district. You know, I don't have to listen to anybody because I am the authority of our church. And they understand that. But I would not do something in our district without first speaking to my district superintendent. Why is that? Well, Pastor, you the man. You can do whatever you want to do. No, I cannot, because I'm under authority. And I'm in an organization where I'm under authority. So there are things that we must all be recognize, you know, we must all recognize and hold ourselves accountable to do. And so, yeah, there are so many times I want to do things and certain things that maybe I won't even do in our church, but I don't know how to do it. I'll reach out to my bishop and I'll say, listen, you know, I know that you know some things about this, you know, and submit myself. You know, I don't know everything. Sometimes we all are still learning as we're going along, and we call upon somebody else that knows more than we do and that can, you know, kind of shadow us and make sure that we're doing it right from the get-go. So I'll call up and you know, before I even did certain things in our church, I called up my bishop. I said, listen, I know you did this. You were successful. How did you do it? And as I began to do it, I would call him up and I'd say, well, how about this? And, you know, can you share this with me? And how about that? So that I wouldn't make the mistakes that he made. Hello, somebody. You know, wisdom says, I got to go find out about this thing so that I can get it right from the beginning. And then, you know, it'll be perfect right out of the gate. But when we go out and we try it on our own, and it failed and it failed and it failed and we keep trying and it failed and it tried and then it makes it and we're so excited. That's just experience, man. That's not wisdom. Wisdom says, I'm going to go find somebody that knows and I'm going to ask them so that when I go out there to do ministry that God has called me, I have authority over me that's watching out for me and I'm doing what I'm supposed to do. That requires patience. It tells us to wait on our ministering. Amen. It says, take time to get to the level where God needs you to be. Here. In our emotions, because sometimes we're excited, sometimes we're even so gifted, better than everybody else, but we're not ready yet because we don't have what it takes. And then, listen, we need to do things. The Bible says, do it with simplicity when we're doing ministry. When I looked up that word, it means to do things without self-seeking. We don't do it for others to see us, but to simply be a blessing. That's to do things without wanting others to see me do it. You know, don't make announcements about what you've done. Just, and then when others have done something and you go up to make an announcement, give credit to that person for what they did. Don't say we, because it wasn't you. You give credit to somebody else and thereby elevating somebody else over yourself. Amen. If you've accomplished it, there's nothing wrong with saying, and you know, the Lord spoke to me and I did this and I did that. But when it's somebody else and they've spoken in, give that person credit. Why am I saying these things? Because self-seeking is such a big problem in our society today. Everything is about the individual and what we want and all of that. And I talk about this a lot because I see it a lot. I see it outside of the church. I see it inside the church. I see it in preachers. I see it in pastors and bishops. And the Lord is saying, no. Let's be simple. Let's just be simple. We're all stones in the building. Yes, some of us may have authority over others by reason of the gift and the calling that God has placed and the anointing that God has placed upon our lives. I remember someone looked at me once and they were, you know, calling me and I heard, Bishop. And I turned around because the person got real close to me. I said, excuse me? They go, Bishop. I said, listen, pastor is fine. There's some demons at the bishop level that, no. Don't elevate me until God is ready to elevate me. You see, we are so into titles, but we don't realize that with the responsibility and that anointing, there comes the test. I'm not ready for some tests. Don't be pouring it out on me. When God decides that I'm ready to be able to be so-called elevated. I don't even like that word. But when God says it's time for you to do something else, I'm going to anoint you for this thing. I want to be ready here, and in my emotions. And not only that, in my education, in my learning, so that when I go out there, I'm helping somebody. Come on now. I'm really building the kingdom of God, not making mistakes over and over and over again and causing problems until I get to that level where I'm supposed to, where if I had been patient and waited on God, I would have been there now. I would have been learning all this time while I'm waiting and now I'm ready to go. And you know what I love about waiting and being patient and then getting to the place where now you are able to function in the new anointing that God has placed in your life? You're not self-seeking anymore. All that hard work, prayer, going through hell and high water, going through trials and tribulations. So now that you are at that place where God is using you, that anointing won't even elevate you above anybody, because you know that you didn't get here by yourself. And you know that what you're dealing with right now is just a task that God has laid on you, and he's prepared you for work. Come on, somebody. But you are not going to be that person if you lack patience and if you're still seeking yourself, your, you know, self-aggrandizement. If you, you know, oh, you got to pay me. That's right. You know, give me lip service. Then there's diligence. Mm-hmm. That's right. You see, there are some people, you know, that don't understand what this word diligence means. But diligence in the Greek means eagerness, enthusiasm, and with haste. So all wrapped up in one, you feel something very special in your spirit and in your heart. I've got to do this for you, Lord. I've waited. Now I'm ready. And God opened every door. And then God opens every door. And you're ready to go. Nothing stops you. You are focused. Diligence. That's what that is. You are focused. You're enthusiastic. It doesn't matter whether the sun is in the sky or not. You get up with an enthusiasm that's unquenchable. And you can get the work done because you're ready. You had patience. You had diligence. You learned. You were patient and learned during the times that God kept you. Some of us, God is going to hold us for years. God kept me in the wings for years. And I wasn't really pushing, but and then God had to kind of like kick me out the gate because I knew that there were some things that I was going to have to go through. I'd seen it in so many of my own friends that had been called to the ministry and family members that had been called to the ministry. I'd seen it in my own pastors as God elevated them, as God used them and what they had to go through. And I'm like, no, not me. You know, but when God gives you, when God calls you, amen, he always provides what you need. So don't ever be afraid to be called by the Lord. Pastor, I don't want to go through all of that. No, no. When he calls you, he's going to give you what you need to be able to accomplish. Trust me on that one. Been through it. I'm still going through it. Hallelujah, somebody. But this diligence now, amen. You know, it allows you to be able to look at others and be glad for them while you're waiting for yours. If you can't rejoice when God is blessing somebody else, when God has anointed somebody else, when God is using someone else's gift, and you know your gift is better than their gift, and you know that you've got that ability better than theirs, but God is using them and not you, and you just sit there pouting, and you can't rejoice and sing with them, then you know you're definitely not ready for God to release you. You're definitely not ready. And you know what? You better sit right there, because if you don't sit there and wait, you're going to go out there, you're going to release yourself, and you're going to have nothing but trials and tribulations, worse than you have had, until God breaks you and makes you what you need to be. So don't go that route. You stay right where you are and be patient, and don't start carrying on about, well, my gift is better. It may be better, but you're not ready. And you know, the Bible tells us this, that a man's gift, a woman's gift, a boy's gift, a young lady's gift will make room for them. In other words, when it's time, God's timing, that God will open every door for you. Whether you like it or not, you're going to be propelled out there, and you're just going to have to be ready. That's why you need time of preparation, you know, and you need a time of getting close to God, so that you can see you're building the Lord's kingdom. You're seeing that your job really right now is not to build up yourself, but to build somebody else up. So your gift is not for show and tell, so that everybody can see who you are and go tell somebody else about you, but your gift is there so that it can release the gift in somebody else. Amen. And this is where all of this comes in, being patient. But you know, Lord, let me get to the last thing. Cheerfulness. Can somebody say cheerfulness with me right now? Cheerfulness. Cheerfulness. Yeah, let's get to that real quick. Cheerfulness. You don't want to be around some Christians. Yep, they're very cheerful. Yep, always cheerful. Very negative. They bring you down with them. They never look at the positive, only the negative. They never smile. You know, there's just something about them that you wonder. You see them walk into the church and you're like, okay, what's going on? When you are in the body of Christ, remember, we're not building for ourselves. We're building for God. The Lord is using each and every one of us. He calls us to ministry in one way or the other, because we're all a part of this body. So when we come in to the body of Christ, and when I say come in, we're not just talking about the local church where we are, the building you walk into every Sunday when you go in to worship the Lord, but wherever you go, you're bringing Christ with you. You're bringing the brothers and the sisters with you. We may not be there with you, but you represent Christ. You represent the pastor. You represent the other brothers and the sisters. Someone once said to me, you know, I don't understand what's happening, because this person is supposed to be a Christian, but they're not exemplifying what Christianity is all about. And I thought about that and I said, what an indictment against that poor pastor in that local church, especially if that pastor has been preaching his heart out and the saints of God has been trying to help somebody and they still don't do what they're supposed to do. Do you know what really happens? The entire church gets labeled because of one person that's out there not doing the right thing. And so it's important for all of us to remember, whether we're in the body of Christ, at the local assembly, at your house in front of your family, or out in front of strangers, don't assume they don't know who you are. And don't assume that they don't know where your church is. And so we've got to be an example of Christ. You know, not this type of cheerfulness, and certainly not this. Because, you know, when we bring nothing but doom and gloom, always complaining, only supporting what we're interested in, only supporting that person that we like and that we know that, you know, that's the person that's always building me up. And so I'm going to build them up, quid pro quo, as they call it. But then what about that poor person? They have not even been in the church long enough. They don't know what their gifts are, their anointing. Man, they're just barely struggling to get to church every Sunday. Some of them, when they walk out of the church building and they go home, they're walking into abusive relationships. They're walking into homes and relationships where they have no voice, where maybe there's sickness and disease. They're taking care of a family member. They're always down, and truly they should be the ones to really be doomy and gloomy. But they come to a church where we talk about Christ being the hope of glory, Christ being the deliverer, Christ being the one that brings joy unspeakable and full of glory, Christ, the one that said he would never leave you nor forsake you. And then, you know, we kind of like bring this to the table, this type of cheerfulness. Whew, Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost. And boy, I tell you, we've got to remember who we are. We are lively stones in the body. And yeah, there may be days we don't feel like it, but that's why we need a deep walk in God and teaching, so that we understand who we are and that we need to stand close to him, so that he's covering us with his grace, so that when I feel like being doomy and gloomy, that something else will shine in me and I'll put a smile on my face. Isn't that something? So let's get rid of this and let's do what the Lord wants us to do. First Peter, we're going to end with this scripture, chapter 2 and verse 5. It says, "You also, like lively stones, are being built into a spiritual house." You see, we are the body of Christ. We're being built into a spiritual house. How are we being built? Are we even allowing the hands of God to touch us, to motivate us, the Holy Ghost to help us, to streamline the gifts and the anointings in us and to elevate those things within us and to get rid of the wastes, the things that the Lord wants to get out of us? Are we allowing the Lord to say, I'm going to fashion you as a stone that I can put in my building, my holy temple? But are we there yet? Are we at that point where we're allowing the Lord to do it for us? He says, "You also, like lively stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood." We're called to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Amen. So here we are, offering spiritual sacrifices. Spiritual sacrifices. That means I'm sacrificing my attitude, whether I feel like people are for me or against me. It's all right. I often said that, you know, if a little kid goes up to teach or preach the gospel, the focus should not be on the child, it should be on the word that they're about to speak, because God can use anyone. He can even use anything. The Lord used a donkey to take a wayward, backslidden, if you even want to call him a backslidden, some people call him a backslidden preacher, Balaam. I call him a false prophet because that's exactly what he was. But a false prophet nonetheless that listened to the voice of God and did not go and curse the children of Israel according to the king of Moab's words. In fact, he had to like go round about and show the king of Moab how to get the people of Israel to sin. But he just couldn't outright prophesy curses upon them, because even a backslidden prophet, if you want to call him that, an idol worshiper prophet, he listened to the voice of God. How about us, the people of God? Amen. Tonight, I hope you got a good word from the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. The spiritual house. The spiritual house. And we are lively stones in this body. Can we go before the Lord in prayer right now? Holy Ghost, we come. We're so thankful, God, that we are your children. Thank you for a word tonight. A word, God, that will help us to check our identities. God, we are your children, the sheep of your pastures. And we come before you, God, with thanksgiving and into your courts with praise tonight. God, help us, God, that the people of God will allow your spirit to help us, that whatever we do, whether in the church, the local church, or out in the world, God, it will bring honor. It will bring honor and not dishonor to the work of the Lord. Because after all, Lord, we are a spiritual house, your holy temple. And everybody said, in Jesus' name, amen. Remember, we are going to be having early registration on April 26th for Mother's Day services. And we're going to be doing just as Easter, holding two services on Mother's Day. All right. So look out for that and make sure you register. And remember again, if you are not going to come to church, cancel your registration by Friday evening. If you don't do that, you're not giving us a chance to be able to let others know that's on the waiting list that they can come. And if you call us or try to cancel on Sunday morning or Saturday evening, it's kind of like, not a good thing. All right. So please work with us, register early, and God bless each and every one of you. And I hope the Bible study was a blessing to your hearts and into your minds. Amen. Until Sunday, the Lord bless you.